so find your seats, please. Faculty members, as always, remember to sign in and remember to get your evaluation and complete that and return it so that you can get CME, so that you'll have that one as license renewal time. Residents, remember that there's an all-resident meeting here immediately after Grand Round, so as soon as we stop, we'll do that. Today we have Dr. Bob Nalal coming to speak to us. She received her PsyD, Doctorate of Psychology, from Wright State University and is currently working at Velen in the outpatient department. Her research focus was on trauma. Her dissertation was on training needs of clinicians working with sex traffickers, sex trafficking in India. She'll today be talking to us about narcissistic personality disorder and some psychodynamic aspects of that, which is, I think, something we haven't talked about for a while, so we really appreciate your being here. So join me in welcoming her, please.
So today I'm going to go over the specifics of narcissistic personality disorder from a psychodynamic perspective. So these are the lyrics of a song by the Beatles. All I can hear, I need mine, I need mine, I need mine. Even those tears, I need mine, I need mine, I need mine. No one's frightened of telling it, everyone's saying it. Way more food than wine, all through your life, I need mine. We're going to look at the case of Bruce, right? Bruce is a 60-year-old African-American male. He's the only child of an abusive father and depressed mother. He's been engaged twice and has no children. He has an acquired disability due to 3 recent strokes and 2 heart attacks.
Next slide.
He uses a cane to assist with ambulation at this time and depends on others for transportation due to some neural damage in his right leg and arm. He avoids using his cane in an effort to seem stronger and healthier than he is, which leads to frequent falls. And his current diagnosis is major depressive disorder in the context of narcissistic personality disorder. So the major goals for this presentation are to define narcissistic personality disorder, apply psychodynamic theory to the understanding of how narcissism develops, compare conceptual differences among different authors on narcissism, and describe narcissistic defenses against disabilities. All of this will be in order to kind of help us gain a better understanding of who Bruce is and what he's been going through. So many theorists over time have discussed underlying dynamics as to the cause of the causes and definitions related to narcissistic personality disorder, which I'll probably refer to as NPD and narcissistic personality disorder throughout. Today we're going to focus mainly on the ideas of Sigmund Freud, Theodore Mohan, Heinz Kohut, Otto Kernberg, and Nancy McWilliams. While this isn't nearly an exhaustive list of clinicians and theorists who have worked on this, these individuals have helped shape our understanding of what the disorder is and its etiology. We'll also look at a few more recent researchers in the field of NPD, modern takes on the disorder, as well as touch on the possible physiological causes of NPD. So NPD gets its name from Narcissus, as told in Ovid's book, Metamorphosis. The story tells of Echo, a nymph who fell in love with Narcissus, a hunter known for his looks. Narcissus spurned her love and continued on with his hunt. When she faded into the mountains, her heart broken, Narcissus kind of went on, and he was soon cursed by the gods to learn one day what it's like to love and not have that love returned. So as he was on the hunt, he was tired and thirsty and laid down near the water when he looked at his reflection and fell in love. And he couldn't tear himself away, and there he died. And from where his body lay in decay rose a flower, which has been from then on known as the Narcissus flower. So before we get into the theory behind NPD, let's explore Bruce and his history for a moment. So he's a high school graduate who completed his 1.5 years of college and his degree in communications while in Colorado. He stopped pursuing his degree after being hired by a local radio station as a radio jockey. He worked in Colorado for a number of years while traveling back and forth from Philadelphia before eventually moving back to Philadelphia in order to be closer to his mother. husband spent 6 years working as an eyeglass tech and on and off as a radio jockey. So after his mother's death, he attempted to move to Las Vegas but was unable to find a job. And he still holds a lot of anger regarding this failure. He's been unable to maintain gainful employment since prior to his attempts to move to Las Vegas, and as such, right now has no savings or means of income. At this time, he has two open court cases, one with a radio station who he believes behaved in a racist manner against him, and the other is a disability claim which has been denied twice already. Again, he's had two heart attacks. They were within 12 days of each other about 6 years ago, and over the 6 year period, he's had at least two strokes. He believes he had a third one in the past 6 months. He was hospitalized during the time that we were working together, but he didn't tell me about it until after he got out of the hospital. He's been put on suicide watch after his second heart attack due to telling the doctors to just let him die, stop treatment, don't do anything. Prior to this, he never had any significant health problems. He believes his medical problems are a sign of weakness and avoids seeking help until there's no other options that are available to him. As such, he's often non-compliant with medical advice, including physical therapy and medication compliance. He believes he should never need anyone's help and be able to fix himself alone. And as such, the realization that right now he needs other people is really, really difficult for him. So he's been in and out of physical therapy for the last about 6 years as well. He'll go for about 2 months and then quickly stop going. He'll take medications for a week or two, decide they're not working, and stop taking them, or decide that they have too many side effects after he's done a little bit of research and stop. So he has an abusive relationship with his father and feels that he was never seen as good enough. His father would often ignore his existence. His father was very verbally and emotionally abusive towards him. Every time that Bruce had a heart attack or a stroke, his father would literally just leave him on the floor where he was, tell him that he's being too attention-seeking, or just huff and walk away. And so every time Bruce had to find a way to call 911 himself, get to the hospital himself. The second time he was at the hospital for his first heart attack, he was told, is there anywhere else you can go? Because we, the medical professionals, believe that if you go back to your father's home, you're gonna die. You're gonna have another heart attack, you can have another stroke, which inevitably he did. He described having a dependent and very enmeshed relationship with his mother. So his mother would often, his mother was very unhappy with his father. And so she had a number of affairs, one that she ended up marrying after she divorced her father. And when she would go on these affairs, when she would go to a hotel overnight, Bruce would be the one who was driving her there. He would be the one who was waiting for her outside the hotel as her cover, so that the father would never find out that she was having an affair. She told him multiple times that you were born to protect me and that's your only use. So he's had a lot of that growing up. So the predominance in mythology, if you look at it, then exists at kind of a pre-Oedipal level, right? Where when his relationship with his mother was tantamount and Oedipal tension relating to his father hadn't really arisen yet, right? It was just him and his mother at this point. His father was kind of a side figure who didn't come into the relationship. So this is the stage at which personality disorders usually are seated, right? This is where they start. This includes his fears of abandonment, his diminished sense of self-worth, and rage at his attempts to maintain his mother's absolute attention and really failing to do so. So his disordered behaviors were then further punctuated by a lack of maternal modeling of healthy boundaries and behavior. And then given that the Oedipal phase is fueled by this pre-Oedipal tension, there's a high level of Oedipal drama in the home. So there's a high level of rage and jealousy towards his father, and then a general fear of other men. So if you look at the inconsistent parenting and lack of love and support he received as a child, it kind of makes sense that he is where he is now, right? And it makes sense that he doesn't look to others to get his needs met and has difficulty being trusting and vulnerable to others. With regards to mental health, he's never been inpatient and has only met with one therapist prior to meeting with me. He met with this previous clinician about 3 years ago and terminated therapy pretty quickly. He met with her for about 3 months and then grew very, very angry with her because she gave him a diagnosis of narcissistic personality disorder and never went back. So he has a long-standing history of depression and suicidal ideation with daily thoughts of death. His most recent suicide attempt was about 6 months ago when he consumed half a bottle of gabapentin, and he waited 3 weeks to inform me of this overdose, stating that he didn't want to bother me with the information. And he'll often express ideation in session and then deny it by saying, "Don't worry about it." So he'll come in and he'll be like, "I'm just gonna die, I want to die." I'll ask him, "All right, have you thought about how to do this?" Every day. "Are you gonna do it?" "I can't tell you that, don't worry about it." "Do you need to go to the hospital?" "No, I'm never going to a hospital." It took a while and a couple of crisis sessions to figure out that it's not real intent. It's just kind of this almost borderline way of seeking attention. He just wants me to be very, very concerned. He wants people around him to be very concerned, people around him to want to check in on him all the time and make sure that he's okay. That need was met when he was doing this. So we had a couple of conversations on how he can't keep doing that, and if he does it again, I'm going to 302 him, and they stopped pretty quickly. So socially, he believes that he's kind of the glue that holds his friends group together, but he's unable to ask his friends for help when he needs it for fear of being seen as weak or as a burden. He's unwilling to allow his friends to see him as anything less than perfect. And has difficulty letting anyone in. He's incredibly protective of the women he gets into relationships with, but he usually only gets into relationships with married women who are in abusive relationships. So he only finds women that he needs to protect and who need him to do that for him. He's had friends reach out to him over the last 6 years saying, "Hey, let me pick you up and take you to the mall. Let me take you to this Corvette convention that we're going to." And he always says no. And when you ask him about that, his response is similar to, "Batman doesn't need anyone, and I'm like Batman, so I don't need anyone." Bruce literally thinks that his history and Batman's history is more or less the same. He believes they both had absent parents, and they both had really terrible childhoods, and so he is Batman. It's not a psychotic feature or anything, it's just this belief that he has to be superhuman, that he has to be this perfect protector who can never need help from anyone. So let's kind of move into the history of narcissism. So according to Freud's 1914 essay titled Narcissism and Introduction, the word narcissism as we know it didn't come into common use until the late 1800s, when Havelock Ellis coined the term narcissist-like as a psychological attitude. Then in 1899, Paul Naki began using the term narcissmus as a way of identifying individuals who treated their own selves as one might treat a sexual object, stroking and fondling until full satisfaction is attained. In 1910, Freud became among the first theorists to classify narcissism as a normal aspect of development, rather than a sexual perversion. Then in 1939, Karen Horney began to formulate the essential features of the personality type as they would eventually be seen in the 1980 DSM-3, where narcissistic personality disorder was first mentioned as a diagnostic category. So prior to 1980, it wasn't narcissistic personality disorder. People just referred to narcissism or people with narcissistic features. And then prior to 1980, NPD came about. So in the DSM-5, NPD is categorized as a cluster B personality disorder. It's defined as a pervasive pattern of grandiosity, a need for admiration, and lack of empathy. It's usually diagnosed in early adulthood and can be diagnosed if an individual has significant impairments in personality and interpersonal functioning in the areas of identity, self-direction, empathy, and intimacy, as well as the pathological personality trait of antagonism characterized by grandiosity and attention seeking. If you look up, I've got the exact criteria up here. I won't read that out to all of you, though, so I'm sure you can check that out if you need. according to the APA, there's only a 0 to 6.2% prevalence rate of NPD in the general population. It's more commonly diagnosed in males than females, with 50 to 75% of all diagnosed individuals being male. A 2015 study by Brian Burst and colleagues, however, found that men are more likely to be diagnosed with NPD than women with the same symptoms and history due to a clinician's gender bias. So that's something to just be aware of, right? If you have an individual, a female, who is coming in and she has these symptoms, these issues that are going on, it is important to consider NPD as a diagnosis. So beyond that, approximately 45 to 50% of individuals diagnosed with NPD has a dual diagnosis of major depressive disorder, and 5 to 11% with bipolar disorder, and 24 to 64.2% have substance abuse disorder. More recently, NPD has been categorized into empirically verified subtypes in order to better describe the range of presentations. These are classified as the grandiose overt subtype, the vulnerable covert subtype, and the healthier high-functioning subtype. In Bruce's case, prior to his strokes and his heart attacks, he was likely to have been in that high-functioning grandiose section, right? He likely wavered between the two of them. At this point, because of the disabilities that he's got and because of everything that's happened, he is much more in the vulnerable covert subtype. So due to the variability in presentation and the wide range of severity, there's often a lot of diagnostic confusion. And while the DSM-5 is able to capture a lot of the very important aspects of NPD, it fails to address core psychological features such as vulnerable self-esteem, a sense of inferiority, boredom, and affective reactivity. Okay. So Freud argued that narcissism is the libidinal complement to the egoism of the instinct of self-preservation, or the energy and desire involved in an individual's instinct to survive, the primary narcissism. Secondary narcissism then occurs when the libido withdraws from non-self objects, primarily the mother. At this point, a relationship with social reality is produced and also births the potential for what he called megalomania. It is from the flawed transition between primary and secondary narcissism that pathological narcissistic disorders in adulthood give rise. In his essay, Freud further theorized that narcissism stems from a libidinal self-centeredness, or a child's feeling that its caretakers cannot be dependent upon to provide love reliably, and as such, give up on the hope and desire to be loved and form strong external attachments. Rather, they only look to themselves for love and acceptance. Bruce was never really able to separate from his mother as a libidinal object, rather finding self-love only through unmeshed interactions with her, such as helping her meet her lovers and being told that he was only born to protect her. Thus, he ended up finding no true meaning of his own existence after her death. And so these are some of the quotes that he said to me in therapy. "I don't have meaning anymore, and I have no more dragons to slay." After her death, he didn't have anyone to protect, so he didn't have any meaning in his life. He didn't have an abuser to protect a woman from, so he didn't have a dragon to slay. Which is likely the reason that he then finds these women who are in very abusive relationships and takes them under his wing. So Heinz Kohut took a somewhat different perspective on narcissism than Freud. In his 1971 article, he suggests that narcissism is a part of normal development in which caregivers must provide a strong and protective presence for the child to identify with, which then reinforces a growing sense of self through the mirroring of the child's qualities. Though the child will be able to build a cohesive sense of self, if the parents are unable to provide this presence or have misperceptions of the child's actual emotional state, this sense of self will be fragile and flawed. As such, they are developmentally arrested at a stage where they require specific responses from people in their environment in order to maintain a cohesive sense of self. He explains the etiology of narcissism as resulting from distant, under-stimulating parental self-objects, such as his father, who pretty much just ignored his existence all the time. So he stresses the importance of self-objects, and you may wonder what those are, right? So self-objects are the objects of an individual's fixation at which the narcissistic transference is aimed. Self-objects can be individuals, including parents, friends, romantic figures, as well as a thing or an event, like an intangible idea, music, or a feeling. They provide support to the vulnerable self, allowing for healthy coping in the face of stress, and are not considered to be separate from the self. Bruce was unable to form attachments to self-objects beyond his cars and his career after his mother's death, and as such, his overall failure to develop healthy object relations has led to a pretty empty internal world, and he lacks a lot of emotionally deep and meaningful experiences. He says that he doesn't have any real friends, anyone that he's able to connect with. None of the relationships he's been in have been meaningful or done anything for him, per se. Kohut then further speculates that individuals strive to become complete and non-defective, capable of living healthy, fulfilling lives by building what he calls an uninterrupted tension arc. This arc begins with the individual's basic ambition, which is grandiose and exhibitionistic, growing into their basic talents, which is the twinship or alter ego, and forms a continuum from both poles, finally completing with their basic ideals. However, if the structure is somehow incomplete, or there is an unresolved Oedipal conflict, the result will be that the individuals will react to narcissistic injuries with temporary breakups in their sense of self, enfeeblement, or disharmony. These deficits in structure for individuals with narcissism are filled through reactivation of the need for narcissistic substance that are not provided in childhood. In the case of Bruce, it seemed as his constant pull for praise and validation regarding his worth and vulnerability in virile masculinity. So often in therapy, he'll tell me, I have to be better than everyone else, otherwise I'm not good enough. He will tell me stories of all of the wonderful things he's done, how he was this short, small guy who became the best hockey player on his team, and he was the best football player in his school, and how all these national level teams wanted to take him on. He has told me stories of how women basically falling down on him like rain. All this in an effort to get praise and validation from me. So Milan then suggests that NPD develops in children who are either raised by cold parents or who are distant, remote, or disinterested, or by overindulgent parents who are inappropriately admiring and put the child in an elevated stature. This is further supported by a 2006 study by Otway and Vignoles, which found that both vulnerable and grandiose forms of narcissism can be predicted by an individual's memory and recollections of excessive parental admiration or coldness. So they found that link between the admiration and coldness and narcissism. So Bruce's mother, as with many parents of children with NPD, really inflated his usefulness to really unrealistic levels that were very unattainable, right? And so Malone stated that narcissism is essentially an overvaluation of personal worth. And Beesy then expanded on this theory with the speculation that narcissism is called by parental failure to provide adequately frustrating experiences which will allow the child to develop a realistic sense of self and a realistic sense of the world. So if you look at Willy Wonka, right, and you have Veronica, the girl who is very, very spoiled. She wants a squirrel, she'll get a squirrel. The ones that are like cracking open the nuts or something in the movie. She wants a pony, she gets 10 of them. And so she has no understanding that she can't get what she wants, that she shouldn't get what she wants, and that she doesn't deserve what she wants. And so, in that sense, she has that NPD because it's this, she hasn't been provided with an adequately frustrating experience, which at the end of the movie she does, but yeah. So in Bruce, this is exemplified through his belief that he's the best in any field he chooses to work in, that he is the epitome of a perfect boyfriend, greatest son, and the most amazing friend that no one can ever match up to. He also has this overall sense of being unique and special, right? And this was, again, a message given to him by his mother. So he comes into therapy, and one of his biggest issues is having to sit in the waiting room with other people. Because he's not like them, he's special. He doesn't need to be there because they're crazy and he's not. He wants me to know very much that everyone knew that he was the best and that he deserves more money than he's willing to settle for in these lawsuits. he's not getting any money from the lawsuits. That has been made very, very clear to him by both his lawyer and the opposite party. but he is still fighting for it because he believes that he absolutely deserves it. At the time where he was removed from this radio station, he was still in a probationary period. It was still within a week of his being hired. And so they are within their legal limits to let him go. But he has trouble understanding this, and he has trouble accepting that anyone would not want him. So it's also, with this overvaluation, there's a belief and an expectation that others are going to recognize and cater to this high esteem. I gave him my emergency cell number because I was worried that he might do something to hurt himself, and I wanted him to have that as a possible point of contact along with other emergency numbers, 911, crisis numbers. And he began sending me pictures of corgis and of corvettes, and he doesn't understand why this isn't okay. He doesn't understand why I don't fall in love with it, and I don't love them as much as he does, because he wants me to cater to how amazing he is and these wonderful things that he's sending me in order to get me to essentially fall in love with him. So this underlying belief can, to a point, be very, very conducive to success. It allowed him to present as highly confident and competent to others. And this confidence helped him gain a lot of jobs, very quickly go through girlfriends, like pick up women very, very easily. But when this expectation isn't met, individuals with NPD experience a lot of vulnerability to depression and anger, kind of like he currently is. He's had a number of talents and competencies which he was able to very successfully play to, but also a deficit in emotional development due to parental failure to provide adequate emotional attunement and modeling. Due to this, he was unable to sustain functioning over long periods of time and was easily wounded or enraged when others were unwilling or unable to provide the necessary soothing that he needed. So while healthy individuals are able to have a reality-based and flexible sense of self and flexible experience of themselves, Bruce developed a very fragile sense of self dependent on his need to be exceptional and thus incapable of coping with narcissistic wounds. As such, he's unable to maintain any of his jobs or relationships over a long period of time, and often sought to have his grandiose needs met through having affairs with married women or switching jobs on a whim. Individuals with NPD also tend to have a preoccupation with matters of adequacy, power, and prestige, meaning that status and superiority must always be in their favor. This is exemplified through his belief that his friends and coworkers always looked up to him, saw him as a protector of his rights, and number one confidant, even though he always held subordinate positions at work. And unfortunately for Bruce, his long-standing lawsuit, health problems, and acquired disabilities are actively working against this belief. So when he talks about work, he tells me stories of, as soon as I walked into the building, everyone knew I was there, because there would be whispers going through the hallways that, oh, Bruce is here, Bruce is here. When I got fired, everyone called me and said that this was so unfair. Everyone knew that you were the best. I was able to switch from one job to the other just like that, because I am the best, and I learned the quickest, and I'm pretty much the greatest at everything I've ever done. So as can be seen with many individuals with NPD, he really externalizes his problems, right? The doctors were bad. My physical therapist didn't try hard enough, and that's why I left physical therapy. If I could do it on my own, I would have been better by now. I could have started driving by now. My doctors, they left me to die. It's their fault that I am the way I am. If they had taken care of me faster or done better, then I wouldn't have these disabilities right now. So he works hard to prove his virility and strength to others, including me. And often through very unhealthy means, such as very frequent boundary violations in therapy and over-sexualization of the therapist. He's told me very often to come to Vegas with him. He did, however, promise me my own room if I really wanted it. He told me, I'm better than all of those people out there. He told me, I don't need therapy. I only come here because it's nice to have something pretty to look at. He's told me that he only comes because it's nice to talk to me and have a pretty woman to talk to. And he doesn't understand why a woman like me doesn't wear a ring on her finger, and he would be happy to provide me with one. Narcissistic people, such as Spruce often organize their personalities around maintaining their self-esteem through external affirmation due to having a subjectively empty internal world. He attempts to live a life which he can feel good about himself, and as with most individuals, his self-confidence, his sense of confidence and pride is enhanced by approval and injured by disapproval from others. However, his need for external approval is often eclipsing other pertinent issues in his life, to the extent that others may see him as overly preoccupied. So while all people in some way want approval, Bruce's need would be considered unhealthy or disordered. As many with the diagnosis of NPD, he tends to be preoccupied with outer appearances, and as such may end up feeling fraudulent and loveless as he has ignored his true self. Right? His sense of being good enough is based off of whether he can go to the mall and always be carrying a bag with him to show people that he has money and he can buy what he wants, whether or not he has the latest Corvette, whether or not he has two of them. Right? And right now he can't drive and he has a Corvette just sitting in his father's driveway, and that to him is a huge narcissistic injury because it's just there and he's not driving it. He refuses to go out with people because he can't buy anything. And if he does go out, he will pack a shopping bag before leaving so that it looks like he has bought something while at the mall, because he doesn't want people to know that he can't afford it. And just going and walking around the mall is not an option for him. Okay. Like individuals with NPD, he also has an inbuilt belief stemming from a defensive grandiosity that things will just work out for him and he doesn't need to put much effort into anything. However, when things don't go his way, he turns to fantasy for solace. I deserve to win this case and get a big chunk of money. I can get any woman I want. I'm going to buy two brand new Corvettes with the money I get from the radio station. And other men have always been jealous of me. So he may invent alibis, excuses, and proofs to convince himself of his continued stature and perfection. Right? I was the best at the job, so it made everyone jealous, and that's why they wanted me on. You can't experience the real Vegas without me. Every place I've worked has been racist, and that's why I've had so many problems. So the real Vegas, he decided one day that if I'm going to go to Vegas, I absolutely cannot go unless I either take him with me or I have him on a video call the entire time so he can show me exactly where to go, what to do, and what to see. That did not happen, and he was very upset about that. He also tends to really unrealistically overestimate his abilities and achievements and have a very high sense of entitlement. So social learning theory then suggests that children whose worth is unrealistically overvalued by their parents often have an enhanced self-image that cannot be sustained by the outside world, including Bruce's sense that he must be a protector and cannot have any vulnerabilities which impede this. So if he hurt himself playing sports, he was expected to never mention it and just take care of it himself because he needed to take care of his mother. His father would, again, just ignore any injuries he had. He said that at one point he fractured his wrist and he was expected to just wrap it up on his own, hide it, make sure that no one knew, and just go with it, because he needed to protect his mother, and if he's injured, he can't. All of these factors can lead to long-standing characterological issues, including a need to be loved and admired by everyone, strained relationships with others that lack sustained positive regard, and a general inability to reciprocate love, interpersonal exploitiveness, and a general lack of empathy. Right, and this you've probably seen throughout with his quotes. He just believes that he should get what he wants, no matter what it takes. In 1960, Winnicott explored the idea that individuals with narcissistic personality disorder, or narcissism, often present a false self, a narcissistic extension of their parents or caretakers. This is a presentation of what they've learned is acceptable, and have a constant fear that if they do not play their role, they will be rejected or humiliated, and thus never gain a sense of being good enough. All children are to some extent narcissistic extensions of their parents, right? But the degree, balance, and consequence of them expressing their individuality is what will determine the extent to which this behavior becomes pathological. So all children learn from their parents, but all children are also individuals. So if you push out that individualism from your child and you tell them, no, you have to be just like me, then when a cop believes that that narcissism can come up. So Goldberg then stipulates that these individuals are aware of this psychic fragility and maintain a facade for fear of feeling like they are nobody rather than being somebody, right? McWilliams then posits that there may also be a constitutional component to NPD, as it has been associated with infants who seem to be attuned to unstated affect, attitudes, and expectations of others, such as an infant who cries when her mother feels sad. She further discusses the shame and guilt, which is often seen in individuals with NPD, shame at being seen as bad, somehow helpless, ugly, or impotent, and guilt from the internal critical parent, the superego who strokes conviction of being sinful or wrong. These lead to a defense system of grandiose perfection in which the individual strives to be the best. Then this leads to grandiosity with attainment of perfection or a sense of vulnerability and being inherently flawed rather than forgivably human when failures occur. So while an individual's childhood experience and constitution play an active role in the development of NPD, recent research has found physiological differences in brain structure and gray matter abnormalities among individuals with NPD versus a non-clinical sample. A 2013 study showed a larger volume of gray matter in the left anterior insula as compared to the control group, and they further found that gray matter volume in this region was positively related to self-reported emotional empathy. Further analysis showed gray matter volume in the frontal paralimbic brain regions, including the rostral and median cingulate cortex, and the dorsolateral and median parts of the prefrontal cortex. And then a 2015 pilot study was then able to successfully replicate these results. Multiple studies have also suggested a genetic influence with a 45 to 80% chance of heritability. So when narcissism fails, as you've guessed, the belief systems held by Bruce are difficult to maintain. He was relatively high functioning prior to his strokes, and a combination of interpersonal distance as well as difficulties related to self-awareness and self-disclosure may have allowed him a level of internal control to bypass or hide this internal suffering. Right? This is how he was able to maintain that high functioning level of grandiosity. While individuals with NPD are successful, and many have gained the admiration of others, when an individual fails to gain desired and expected objectives, it can lead to a sense of anger and sadness. It's not my fault, everyone is turning against me. Why me? I don't deserve this. It doesn't necessarily cause depression, anxiety, or difficulties related to work, social, or daily functioning. However, when individuals such as Bruce encounter failures or limitations, they're more vulnerable to these deficits in functioning. When failures are then sustained, the sadness is likely to be externalized with the refusal to acknowledge their own action, such as his poor sleeping and eating habits, his refusal to be compliant with medical recommendation, and general refusal to seek help. I don't think he's ever come to therapy without a bag filled with like Twinkies or Ho-Hos. And that seems to be his normal meals on a daily basis. So in Bruce's case, the sustained failure stems from his perception of himself as having failed by falling ill, his incomplete recovery after the strokes, and not being as physically capable as he was, which is then further compounded by undesired results of his lawsuits and difficult childhood. He attempts to redeem himself, again, by presenting as virile and strong. And when he fails to do so, it worsens his overall sense of failure. So due to his strokes, Bruce has acquired a neuropsychological sequelae, including difficulties related to memory and auditory processing speed, which are both seen in session and confirmed by the Montreal Cognitive Assessment, the MoCA, a neurocognitive screening measure. He often repeats himself and is forgetful, and has shown difficulty in retaining information he has heard and needs things to be explained to him multiple times. His greatest struggle with this is with regards to his loss of his ability to drive and reliance on logistic care to get to appointments. As can be expected for an individual with NPD, he tends to externalize the blame. Right, it's my father's fault that I have strokes and heart attacks. He stressed me out. My financial problems are the radio channel's fault and my lawyer's fault. As such, it's important to look at the relationship between neuropsychological injuries and mental health. So an article by Klonoff and Lang proposes that individuals with a history of narcissistic personality predating an acquired brain injury show a course of recovery marked by intensified problems with accepting and coping with the effects of the injury. Due to a failure to grieve, Bruce often struggles with the reality of his disability, and believes that he will soon be able to return to the level of physical and mental competence he had prior to the stroke. He's also likely to have less positive outcomes related to realistic vocational planning and believes that he is just as able to be a radio jockey, even though he struggles with issues related to sustained attention, concentration, and memory. He will repeat the same memory, the same story to me 3 times in a session, forgetting that he's already told it to me and told it to me this week before and maybe the week before that. So because the subjective experience of his post-stroke recovery is poor, the impact of the stroke on his overall mental health is far worse than it might have been had he had a different outlook. Bruce believes the consequences of his illness are severe, and this impacts his sense of self and self-worth. Further, his newfound isolation, difficulty maintaining social contacts and relationships, and inability to find meaningful work is yet another failure, another narcissistic wound. So he's been telling himself for 6 years that I'll be better by Christmas. This isn't me. I have to get back to being the old Bruce. Such, while he may have had significant acquired disabilities, the effect of the neuropsychological injury has a greater impact on his overall levels of depression and NPD than the actual disability itself. So perhaps then the idea of his failure to mourn the loss of his able body and mind is a consequence. Freud in 1917 posits that mourning is the reaction to the loss of some abstractions such as liberty or an ideal, or in Bruce's case, his ability to be independent, strong, and virile. Mourning itself is not seen as a pathological condition that must be treated. Rather, it's a natural occurrence which will mitigate itself in due time. On the other hand, melancholy or depression is considered pathological and may need intervention to overcome. The main difference between the two, as stated by Freud, is the effect on the individual's self-regard. In depression, one's sense of self is often badly hurt, while the same disturbance is absent in mourning. The work of mourning involves reanalysis of libido memories and expectations of the lost ideal, such that at the end of the mourning period, the ego is again free and unburdened. However, in depression, the individual is often unaware of exactly what they've lost, what happened. So in depression, the individual is unaware of exactly what they've lost, and they're unable to mourn it naturally. So his natural physical talents and mental capacity can be considered his self-objects in this case. And having lost them, he no longer has these healthy object relationships to help him cope, which then further his inability to mourn and recover. He has a sense of omnipotence and grandiosity, which is preserved throughout his life as a defense against his emotional vulnerability, and was never modulated through parental modeling of affect, grief, or sadness in the face of loss. Bruce's difficulty grasping the loss of his independence beyond his ability to drive and be seen as a virile male, and thus cannot mourn the loss of his self-respect and sense of worth as a capable person able to care for others as he deems best. As such, he's unable to free his ego and must then go through the process of understanding what he's grieving in order to mourn and move forward. So what now? What does this mean for Bruce prognostically? He, like others with NPD, has an illusion of competence, an armor of invulnerability, if you will. Right? There's nothing to tell me that I ever told myself. I don't need to be here. Bruce attempts to demonstrate his lack of dependency on his therapist by devaluing her and my attempts to help him, and subconsciously resisting change. He often displays what Kernberg calls a self-self relationship in therapy, in that he will talk to himself in the presence of his therapist or talk to the therapist in attempt to move her towards his desired direction. Any attempt from me as an intervention or as an interpretation is quickly ignored or devalued. As such, he's often left feeling unheard or misunderstood. It's very, very difficult to break the narcissistic pattern in therapy, more so after a neurological injury, right? And so any measurable progress has taken about a year. However, now he's willing to listen to input from me and a little bit from his psychiatrist here and there. He's open to discussing compliance to medical recommendations, though he often does very little more than discuss. So Winnicott further discusses the idea that when treating an individual with NPD, it's important to remember that they're likely to either devalue or idolize the therapist, but do not care to process this transference, as they see it as a waste of time. So we did try and process this once, and it did not go well at all. He goes so far as to recommend that the clinician disclose to the individual times when they've lost empathy for them in the therapeutic relationship, in order to become a more realistic self-object for them, and set an example in which an idealized individual can make mistakes and not lose their sense of esteem. This will allow the individual to see an example of this process and have an opportunity to mirror it. We tried that too. It didn't go over well. But we will continue to try it. So where do we go from here? A 2016 study found that NPD patients don't differ in levels of self-esteem as compared to both clinical and healthy control groups, suggesting that a focus on treatment of underlying low self-esteem may not be fruitful. Rather, our continued goals in therapy are to reduce his depressive symptoms, allowing the opportunity to grieve his losses. This is mainly being accomplished through continued talk therapy with a focus on validation, providing healthy boundaries and interpersonal feedback, helping him engage with his grief, and building hope for a better future. His second goal is to feel motivated to return to physical therapy and maintain compliance with medical advice. However, given his distrust of medical professionals and his general sense that he shouldn't need help, it's difficult to help him gain lasting change in this aspect. He's finally begun seeing a psychiatrist. This took a little over a year to convince him that medication is not evil, and is currently taking trazodone to help him sleep. But he doesn't take it as prescribed and continues to report difficulties with sleep. So he started seeing the psychiatrist and then very quickly said, "I don't like him, he doesn't like me, I'm not going back." He's finally agreed to go back now that his lawyers have sent paperwork saying, "Hey, is this guy in therapy? It will help with his lawyer and it will help with his case." I'm like, "Well, if you go see your psychiatrist, maybe he'll sign up on it." So now he's back. That's great. In terms of counter transference, when I initially began working with Bruce, I had a very strong initial counter transference response, which made me very, very unwilling to work with him. I found him incredibly creepy and incredibly irritating, and I asked to transfer him initially. I'm very glad that I didn't, because as I've gotten to know him better, I actually really enjoy working with him. There were very frequent boundary violations, and as far as I could tell, there was very little to no progress being made. However, with time, supervision, and continued conversation with him, I found that the problem here was my expectations. I expected him to move in leaps and bounds when what he was capable of doing was crawling, right? And so when we took a closer look, he was crawling, he was making progress, and he was continuing to come to weekly sessions. He'd been coming and seeing me for a full year and hadn't terminated therapy yet. He was able to have a discussion on the idea that he has narcissistic personality disorder and continue to come after that. So over the last year and a half, there's been a decrease in the overall number of boundary violations, and the therapeutic alliance has gotten much stronger, which has allowed for more progress. And finally, he's accepted that he may need help from others, if only for a bit. So, thank you all very much. Are there any questions? I believe we have 5 minutes left.
You probably noticed by now that the name of Batman is Bruce Wayne.
Yep.
That's probably where the identification comes from.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, he really does think he and Batman.